Friday we will have a celebration of the 8th anniversary of the project. And therefore the value of the number that I will be showing is completely different from the value I was showing during the first conferences that we had in Paris, Berlin, and Milano in 2011, 12, and 13. At that time, the evolution of LibreOffice and DDF was different. The project was younger. We had a completely different trend in terms of developers coming to the project. Now we have a stable situation. At the time, we have developers coming in, new developers, and many new developers coming in every month. We see that new developers coming in every month, but the number, of course, is different from the past. In general, we, for those who have not received the email, have not seen the website, we have the annual report that covers last year. So in 2018, we published the 2017 annual report. It's available in low and high resolution. The high resolution is rather heavy in terms of a PDF. And then for those speaking German, they can also download the original German, because we present the annual report to the authorities every year around the end of April. The German version, we get an English one that has several more information, because the authorities ask more about the health of the project, why we provide information about communities and other other part of the project. So if you didn't already download it, you're invited to do that. And now let's see some numbers and trends about the project. First one is about the number of users. We have an estimate at the moment of having around 200 million users. This is the way it has been calculated. Of course, we don't invoice for products, which means that we cannot count users by or by keys of the product. So we have 100% of desktop Linux users that, according to estimates, are between 40 and 60 million. Then we think we have around 10% of desktop Windows users that are 180 to 270 million. This is calculated, of course, on the figure of 2.8 billion users, Windows users, and 10% of desktop macOS users, which is around between 16 and 24 million. So what we say, we beat the lower total, which is 136, and we round it to 200 million, because not only we try to be conservative, but of course we acknowledge that there are some duplications. So there is people that is has installed Microsoft Office or another Office suite and LibreOffice, and they may have two computers, so they, even if they have two computers, they account for one user and so on. So this, the last figure we gave was 180, we are up to 200. Actually, when we started, the day we announced, we said that the objective was 200 million users in 10 years. It looks like we got to the objective 2 years before, but I don't think this is really meaningful, because in the meantime the number of PC users has increased quite sensibly. So of course now probably we should look at a higher figure to have a good percentage of the market. But in any case, I think that everyone involved in the project can be happy and proud of what we have achieved during the last 8 years. I don't know if you have ever seen that the TDF dashboard is, the address is dashboard.docfoundation.org, and you can find statistics about the project. And these are commuters. As you see from the number of commuters, this is even more stable. Of course, this is the last week, so last week was not completed when I took the picture. We have a rather stable number of commuters on a monthly basis, which gives a solid base for the project. Of course, we should start to be worried if we see a fluctuation in the number, and of course, we cannot rest on laurels, so we always look for new developers and new contributors, because there is people that is new people and people that is leaving the project for any reason, people getting married, having children, and so on. And these are committers by affiliation, and I just want to show that this is Collabora, this is Red Hat, these are volunteers, this is CIB. So we have the three sponsors of the conference are basically together with volunteer people, the largest contributors to the software. And I would ask for an applause to Collabora, CIB.
WPS Office is a product from China,
and I think that in all China, Chinese-speaking countries, WBS office is rather strong. The same happens in several African countries, because WBS office is a 100% clone of Microsoft Office, so it's the free alternative or the low-cost alternative in countries where they, for some reason, they absolutely need the product that is in like Microsoft Office. In the lower part, you see the top countries in terms of search, amount of search. So it's Brazil is the first, and you have France, Finland, Estonia, and Croatia. Of course, this is a percentage of Google search. So in some cases, the number of searches is lower than what happens in other countries, but the percentage is higher. So these are the last 12 months, and these are the last 30 days. As you see, during the last 30 days, the advantage of LibreOffice has grown. This is a trend that we had during the last few years. Of course, if we look at these Google trends over 5 years, 5 years ago, the visibility of the number of searches of Apache OpenOffice were higher than the number of searches of LibreOffice. We crossed the path in 2-3 years ago, and now we are growing more than Apache OpenOffice. As you can see from the map down there, there still, and I think this is for historical reason, the country where there are more search about OpenOffice than LibreOffice is Germany. I think it's just historical reasons. And then you see there are the sum with the WBS office, Indonesia and some African countries. Thanks to the work of our friends in Taiwan. Taiwan is a solid green, so they make more search. And Japan is a solid green, so they make more searches about LibreOffice than any other product. Of course, you are invited to use these charts to show to the people that you are presenting, because this is a measurement on the popularity of LibreOffice. Of course, we cannot say that we have achieved our objective in terms of popularity. There is still a lot of ground to go. But let's say that the community did a very good job in terms of making LibreOffice popular at least amongst people that are searching on Google. These are the website visits. So you have the red is busy, both on the upper and the lower chart. The blue are downloads in the upper chart and page views in the lower. So of course you have a higher number of page views than visits, and you have a lower number of downloads than page views. But as you can see, downloads and page views are rather low. So this means that our website, the visit to our website, are a large percentage are for downloads, and we probably have to work to have people come to our website, not only for downloads, but also to get information, to learn more about the project. So this is something that we are trying to work and make our website accessed by people, also by people that do not want to download the product but want to get more information. These are the last 90 days. As you see, the trend confirms what was during the last 12 months. This is visits to PDF blog during the last 6 months. So you have the red is visitors and the blue is visits. It's easy to spot when we did the announcements. The number of visits to the blog is a lot higher when we have the announcement. The last one is August, and the first one, the other one is May. We did an announcement. If we go back on February, there will be another spike for the other announcement. What is interesting is that it's slowly, very slowly increasing. but it's not increasing. So if you look at the blue, it's increasing, means that people is staying more time on the block, and the red you don't see because it's, of course the numbers are very high because of the spikes, but it's increasing slowly from around 2000 to 2500 during this time frame. Of course, again, we have to work more to get more visit. We are trying to have periodical blog posts. Maida started a Monday interview, but we will try to add more contents because that is the only way where we can attract more people on the blog. What is interesting, what are interesting are statistics of the other blogs. Of course, the other blogs is our web property that gets more visits at the moment, more than the website, more than the other blogs. But design blog, I think we should acknowledge the work that ICO and the group of people of the design team have done, because you see that we have very good spikes. ICO did an interesting blog post about the new feature of the new design feature of the LibreOffice 6.1. So there is a spike of visit there. And the number of visitors is again slowly increasing. So kudos to ICO and the team, because this is very important. It's very important also because it shows, and I will make us talk about it tomorrow morning. You know that many people complain about the user interface of LibreOffice because they say it's old, etc., etc. Of course, these are most of the people, the comments of these people are comments from people that is coming from Microsoft Office, and of course is a victim of Microsoft Office marketing communication. So they think that the only good user interface is Microsoft Office user interface, so anything that doesn't look like Microsoft Office is not good. We should show them that we are improving, and tomorrow I will show a screenshot of LibreOffice 3, LibreOffice 4, LibreOffice 5, LibreOffice 6, and you cannot recognize LibreOffice 6 from LibreOffice 3. So it has really changed completely, but people is not realizing the width of change, because they look at the ribbon and they think that the ribbon is like a goal for the user interface, which is not. So we should be more able to do and to second the work that ICO and the design team are doing, and to convince people that a good user interface is a user interface that allows you to control the product, not to have a fancy number of icons in front of you, which is exactly the name. Spanish blog. So of course, August 10 has been a fantastic day for every blog, but we have a very good team of Spanish-speaking people. One of them is Cisco, but most of the people that are populating our blog are based in South America. So, in this case, thanks to Daniel Rodriguez, to Carlos Parra-Zaldivar, and to Fito, I don't remember his name, Jaime Barrientos, I think. They are the three people that write most of the blog on the Spanish blog. We should work more, and this is something that I want to do with Mike and with the team. We should work more with the people that are doing this native language property, populating these native language properties, because we have to make them more popular amongst readers, Spanish-speaking readers. So I don't think that all the Spanish-speaking readers are aware that we have a Spanish blog that publishes regularly all the contents in the native language. We have to do a better job. The same, this is the Brazilian blog. Brazilian, of course, although they will refuse forever to acknowledge that, but they speak the same language as Portugal, or a similar language. similar one. For people that is doesn't know me well, I have my son now is adopted and was born in Brazil. So when we, and he speaks Portuguese, of course, when we went to Portugal, myself and my wife could easily understand Portuguese people, and my son said, oh, but I said a single word of these guys that speaking a Portuguese that is not Portuguese. I said, okay, just give up your Brazilian brain for 5 minutes, they speak exactly the same language. So don't pretend that you don't understand, because obrigado is obrigado in Portugal and in Brazil. But anyway, the community in Brazil is doing a very good job, and I think that Olivier, who is here, that we have to thank also Eliane, and Gustavo, and I don't remember the other lady, but Valdir, that are writing the Portuguese, the Brazilian book. We never say Portuguese again, sorry. But for instance, we should let Portuguese people know that we have a blog in Brazilian Portuguese. And we have a German blog. And the German blog is younger than the others. So if you look at the number of visits, which is lower, it's because it's not the same amount of time behind it that the other blogs. But I think that we have to work with the German community to make this blog more popular. Absolutely, because we have, I mean, Mike is fluent in German. Unfortunately, I'm not speaking German at all, but I think we have to work to make the German-speaking community in Europe more aware of the blog that we have that is publishing regular information about microphones. And the last one, this is the youngest, this is the reason why it's only 3 months, statistics. Because the QA blog is 3 months old, and this is something that Cisco is doing on his own. I think there will be possibly more QA contributors in the future, but Cisco is publishing statistics and information about QA on the QA blog. So if you've never seen and visited the QA blog, please do that, because it's interesting and provides very good information on the work that is done behind the scenes at LibreOffice. And that's all for the statistics. So if you have any questions on these numbers, and I'm sure you have some questions. There are two questions there. Sorry?
No question about the numbers.
No question about numbers. Any other question?
Is there an effort for user testing on finding out why people think that the interface is old?
I think that ICO should... Where is ICO? No ICO here. I think it's more a perception than... I don't know, I mean... We should definitely run a user testing on that. But this is what you see if you look at the blogs where there are announcements of LibreOffice, and if you look at the comments, most of the comments say, oh, it's interesting, it's good as a product, but it's unusable because of the user interface. And for instance, I do trainings about LibreOffice in Italy. And when I show people that format page in LibreOffice is under format page, they say, but that's not logical, has always been under file, because it's under file on Microsoft Office. They say, okay, if you want to tell me that it's always been there, this is one story, but don't tell me that it's more logical to have page format under file than under format page, because that is a no-brainer, having it under format page. But people has such a high level of resistance to change in terms of habits, in terms of perceptions, that the user interface of LibreOffice, although has been quite heavily impacted, is perceived as being the same for the last 20 years. So I was here, the gentleman was asking about if we have done user research or user tests about the perception. perception that LibreOffice user interface is so old?
It's a very good question.
Is it true that it's old? Is it really true that this interface is old, outdated, 90s? I mean, I follow this discussion on social media, and sometimes when you read this opinion, it looks so outdated, it's so low. Most situation comes down to the wrong configuration, it's a generic plugin that is being used, which is not really nice. That's the first question. It is very hard to ask the people about a certain style, because if something is completely new, let's say a rhythm style, you cannot ask the user, do you want the rhythm? You can present them, change, then if they're happy or not. It's not so easy. We didn't have to prepare something in advance. We tried to do this notebook bar, and that is some kind of exciting feature. People are interested in asking for it. So I think we do a lot for the user interface, and we get different input with some acceptance of what we have. Conventional interface is very well consumption. The classic use case of Hammerware, they deal with a program in general that is very well accepted by most people, but we also want to provide ways to customize things. So we do everything, but no, we haven't asked if we are up to date. Yes. Everyone knows we are not the leader in the side.
I just want to add something. I think that almost any user knows or understands the fact that we offer a user interface that is configurable, so that you can choose the configuration that is more suited to your desktop, and especially to the size of the screen. So if you have a large screen, the ribbon takes away almost one third of the screen, and it's not optimal at all. Just by the way, the next Office interface is copied by LibreOffice interface. And of course Microsoft will never acknowledge that, but it's the single toolbar interface. It's in the next Office. So the next Office has been announced 2 days ago. You can download it and test it by yourself. So the single line icon is exactly the single toolbar in LibreOffice. Of course, Microsoft will never acknowledge that they've copied that, but we will let the people know that they've copied, because now we can take screenshots. And we have 2 years old screenshot of LibreOffice and 1 month old screenshot of Microsoft Office. And so I will do that in the next few days. Ashok.
You have to
mute the microphone, yes.
Is that since it is a Teams player, an issue that's coming up often, that people are not accustomed to the menu that we have and possibly binding. Is that something that maybe we can repackage and have a setting that says, you know, binding, you know, MS Office or something like that? Is that something you want to help people transition and use LibreOffice or more?
So at the moment we have the notebook app is still experimental, but it's usable. You have to enable the experimental features, but you can have the notebook bar. The notebook bar is based on the same concept of the ribbon. It's not a ribbon, but it's based on the same concept. It's I would say that it's ready on Writer, probably. probably there's still some work to do in the other modules, but with Rider, which is, by the way, Rider is the module where you use most the menu, because it's the one where you have to add features and tweaks to the text. In Excel, usually people that is very smart in Excel, they use a lot of keyboard shortcuts more than the menus. And in Impress, you don't use the menu on the same level. I'm an Impress power user. I said don't use the menus because I configured the template and then it's almost automatic. So Rider is definitely the application where the notebook part is more important. And I think that with the latest improvement and patches, it has improved a lot. If you look, if you have installed 6.1 and enabled notebook bar, you can see the difference. And it looks similar, not the same, of course, it looks similar to Microsoft Office. But again, people will tell you it's not the same, and menu commands are not in the same place. And the typical one is format page, and under you know, it's under file, and it's in the section of printing features, the format page in the Microsoft Office, which is completely weird.
I understand the question more to the classical menu, the standard menu, and where the functions are placed in. We have a recent example from last week. Someone asked send to outline. Why is it under file something in this menu? Wouldn't it be better to have it at whatever tools? Whatever it was. You asked maybe for a menu that is more familiar for Microsoft users. We may have a different way of dealing with functions. You know, from whatever system that say no means to see menus in a different way. And of course, we from the design team move functions around the menu, so you are often not knowing where to function. Myself, I look through the menus to find the place where functions. So your proposal, I understood it correctly, was to have a more customizable usage from one keyboard and menu layout. Classical into something else. You can customize it yourself, you can change all the places where it is, but right now, as far as I remember, you can store it and perhaps export it, or I'm not quite sure. What we do not have is a way to put it into an extension and, let's say, load the keyboard, let's say, the menu layout from the process 5.3, if you're not happy with changes from 5.4, would be awesome. And please do that. Yes. Definitely, it would be nice.